Hello and greetings, lovely person from RPG Mods Fan. This video is part 2 of my walkthrough and review of the Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition adventure Waterdeep Dragon Heist, which was published by Wizards of the Coast in September of 2018. In order not to repeat myself too much, I would highly recommend watching my part 1 video, which covers the adventure's setup and initial quest before watching this video. In this video, I will be going over the adventure's background, which, of course, will be full of spoilers. I will not go in depth into the city of Waterdeep itself. I may do such a video sometime in the future after covering most everything else in the Waterdeep Dragon Heist adventure. Because this video will be discussing the adventure's background, I will try my best not to make this video an exposition dump, and I will try to be entertaining as possible. Chris Perkins mentioned that the adventure takes place in 1492 DR, the year of three ships sailing. However, Dungeon Masters can adjust the year to fit with other adventures. Using the Tomb of Annihilation as an example, you can have the Death Curse start to occur after the events of Waterdeep Dragon Heist. Because the player characters have proven themselves as capable adventurers, the retired adventurer and merchant Syndra Sylvain requests a meeting with them at her place, and tasks them to end the curse. Originally, she is supposed to be located in Baldur's Gate, but the DM can move her to Waterdeep or send an invitation to the characters asking them to journey to Baldur's Gate. However, canonically, Waterdeep Dungeon of the Mad Mage is supposed to be run after the completion of the Waterdeep Dragon Heist adventure. I will now be discussing the adventure itself, and as I stated before, this video will contain spoilers. Unless you are a dungeon master who will be running this adventure for their players, or are a player who already played through this adventure and are watching this video for nostalgia purposes, I would suggest not to watch the rest of this video. Displayed is the structure of Waterdeep Dragon Heist. The left flowchart summarizes its background. The upper right flowchart summarizes its sequence of important events. The lower right boxes summarizes what the adventurers can expect when raiding a villain's lair. So, let's get to it. I will start with the adventurer's background first. Before he was ousted from his position as the Open Lord of Waterdeep, Dagalt Neverember embezzled 500,000 gold pieces from Waterdeep's treasury and hid them in a secret vault called the Vault of the Dragons. Built long ago by dwarves, the vault is warded against all forms of magical detection, scrying, and intrusion. As a security precaution, he arranged all knowledge of the vault's location and defenses to be magically erased from his mind and the minds of his subordinates. The wizard who performed the procedure trapped this knowledge within an artifact called the Stone of Galore. The wizard disappeared shortly thereafter, and Dagalt hid the stone in the Palace of Waterdeep. The Stone of Galore ends up being the MacGuffin plot device for the adventure. Dagalt was in the city of Neverwinter when the other Lords of Waterdeep voted him out of office. He immediately made plans to retrieve the Stone of Galore and smuggle his personal wealth out of Waterdeep. His spies retrieved the stone from the palace, but were intercepted and killed while trying to leave the city. The stolen stone was passed from one hand to another like a common jewel until it wound up in the clutches of the Xanathar Guild. The Stone of Galore is actually an aboleth transformed by magic. In this inanimate state, the aboleth can read the mind of any creature that attunes to the stone, as well as modify that creature's memory. A creature attuned to the stone can also extract information from the aboleth, including lore about Never Ember's vault. At the base of Undermountain and where it meets the sea, there is a subterranean city called Skullport. It is a den to the criminal underworld of Waterdeep. Its most powerful crime lord is a beholder called Xanathar. Hoping to gain a political foothold in Waterdeep, agents of the Zhentarim recently tried to ally their organization with the Xanathar Guild. The architect of this attempt was a clone of the wizard Manshun, a founder of the Zhentarim long thought dead. While the two sides were negotiating in Xanathar's lair, the Stone of Galore was again stolen from where Xanathar had hidden it. The paranoid beholder accused the Zhentarim of stealing it and slew its envoys who were present. When the Zents retaliated by attacking Xanathar Guild outposts, Xanathar took their actions as confirmation that they had stolen it. Now the bad blood between the two factions has begun to spill into the streets, threatening the peace throughout the city of Waterdeep. Who actually stole the Stone of Galore? The answer, a rock gnome named Dalakar. After Lord Neverember used magic to discern the gemstone's location, he sent forth a succession of spies to infiltrate Xanathar's lair and obtain it. Dalakar succeeded where others before him had failed. However, his success will be short-lived. The fireball event in the flowchart will happen after the player characters have settled in their new home of Trollskull Manor. As stated before, the embezzled 500,000 gold pieces are in a secret vault called the Vault of the Dragons. Dagult Neverember managed to convince an adult gold dragon named Orinax to guard the gold until he returns. The Stone of Galore knows where the treasure vault is located, how to get inside, and that a gold dragon is guarding the treasure. To get such information requires one to attune to the stone. Displayed is the flowchart of adventures that are in Waterdeep Dragon Heist. Without going into too much detail in this video, I will briefly go over the sequence of events. My goal is to do a separate video on each of these adventures. In my Part 1 video, I have already discussed the A Friend in Need adventure. So, please, check it out! However, just to be thorough in this video, the first adventure for the player characters is a quest given to them by Volothump Gedrom. It is to find and rescue his kidnapped friend, Floon Blagmar. As a reward, Volo will give the characters the deed to Trollskull Manor. During the course of rescuing Floon, the adventurers also rescue Lord Rainier Neverember, the son of the ousted Open Lord. Because of this, the player characters are now known in Waterdeep, and have attracted the attention of a few factions. These various factions will try to recruit the player characters. Each faction has special missions, aka side quests, for those that join them. In the meantime, as the new owners of Trollskull Manor, the player characters have the opportunity to settle down in their new home and to meet and get to know their neighbors. After some time, a fireball detonates in Trollskull Alley. This prompts an investigation by the Waterdeep authorities and also hurls the characters into conflict with some secondary villains, culminating in a bloody confrontation at a noble estate. The fireball incident also sets into motion the main plot of the adventure and puts the player characters on a collision course with those who want to find and claim Lord Neverember's stolen and hidden cache of gold. Thus, the treasure hunt begins. In Chapter 4 of the adventure, the player characters race to find the gold. The encounters in this chapter and the order in which they occur change, depending on the villain the Dungeon Master chooses for this adventure. The chapter concludes with the discovery of Lord Neverember's treasure vault and a showdown with its guardian, the gold dragon, Oronax. The player character's ultimate goal is to prevent the gold from falling into the hands of the villains of the story. Chapters 5 through 8 provide descriptions of the villains' lairs and can be used at any time and in any order. The player characters might have a reason to visit one or more of these lairs in the course of the adventure. The Dungeon Master should be prepared to make adjustments on the fly and give hints where need be. Again, these villains are meant to be thwarted, not killed. Thwarting the villains does not require the characters to invade their lairs or defeat them in combat. So, it is possible to complete the adventure without these chapters coming into play. Bear in mind, these villains do not want undue attention from Waterdeep's authorities. So, if forced into combat, they will try to knock the adventurers unconscious rather than kill them. Such characters might awaken in an alley, a sewer tunnel, or a prison cell, with or without their gear. Conversely, they might awaken safe and sound in a private residence and being cared for by friendly NPCs who took them in. In my Part 1 video, I have already discussed the joinable factions, but I have done so only briefly. I will now go into a little more detail on the factions. When necessary, factions can also provide aid to its members. Harpers are individual idealists who work behind the scenes to keep power out of the hands of evil tyrants. Any smart, non-evil character can join the Harpers, but they tend to attract more bards and wizards to join. The Harpers suspect that the Zhentarim is wholly or partially responsible for the escalation of violence in Waterdeep. Harper spies might use the adventurers as instruments to get at the truth. The Harpers are not well organized and tend to be chaotic. They have several secret gathering places in Waterdeep, but at the same time, they may conduct their business in bustling inns and taverns. Various nobles and guildmasters in the city are Harper sympathizers. Rhaenyra Neverember is a member of the Harpers. The Lord's Alliance is a confederation of cities and towns along the Sword Coast, including, among others, Waterdeep, Baldur's Gate, Mirabar, Mithril Hall, Neverwinter, and Silvery Moon. Members of the Alliance must come to one another's aid in times of need, and the organization uses field operatives such as diplomats, spies, and assassins to safeguard its interests. Waterdeep is one of the most influential and invested members of the Lord's Alliance. The Open Lord, Laurel Silverhand, takes an active role in managing and operating the Lord's Alliance within Waterdeep. Shalester Silvermane is a member of the Lord's Alliance. The order of the Gauntlet's mission is to seek out and destroy evil before it gains a foothold. Any non-evil character can join the order. Clerics, monks, and paladins are especially welcome, particularly if they worship Helm, Torm, or Tyr. They often act without waiting for the blessings of temples or the permission of rulers, which can put them at odds with those in power. The surge of violence in Waterdeep spurs members of the Order to find and recruit adventurers who can help return peace to the city. The Emerald Enclave's goal is to seek harmony between nature and civilization. Within the city walls of Waterdeep, the Emerald Enclave does not have too many members. The members that are in Waterdeep help guard the city against unnatural threats, including aberrations and undead. They also watch over the city's parks and the City of the Dead. In order to join, a character must demonstrate an interest in protecting nature. Druids and rangers are especially welcome to join them. The highest member of the Emerald Enclave in Waterdeep is Lady Jareth Falcon. However, the real operations are handled by the half-elf druid Melanor Felbranch, Falcon's groundskeeper, and Blossom Snowbeetle, an elderly halfling druid. Her youngest son, Dasher, disappeared about 6 months ago. He was infected with lycanthropy and is now a member of the Shard Shunners, a halfling were-rat gang. The Centaurm, also known as the Black Network, has an open recruitment policy. Anyone can join. It is a shadow organization that trades and traffics anything for profit, including mercenaries, weapons, slaves, illicit substances, and goods. It has long sought to gain political influence in Waterdeep, but the strength of the city's masked lords, nobility, and professional guilds makes that difficult. Currently, the Centaurm in Waterdeep is a fractured organization. Those who support Manchun, who is really a clone, want to destroy the Xenothar Guild and seize political and economic control of the city. Those who oppose Manchun want to expose and destroy him before they are themselves apprehended or driven out of the city by the local authorities. The player characters cannot join Manchun's side, but they can join and receive aid from the Zents who are opposed to him. The leaders of this branch are retired adventurers who have become business entrepreneurs. Their adventuring party was called the Doom Raiders because their specialty was plundering lich lairs. They are desperately trying to gain a legitimate economic foothold in Waterdeep, which requires making alliances with local guilds and nobles. The group's leaders are Devil Starsong, Istrid Horn, Tashlin Yafera, Schemo Weirdbottle, and Siraj the Hunter. Manchun's war against the Xanathar Guild has thrown their plans into upheaval. Charlaxel Bainray leads the renegade drow faction known as the Brigand Daerth. It was originally made up of outcasts from destroyed and disgraced drow houses. A character must be a drow, preferably a male, to join the Brigand Dareth faction. Sharlaxle Bainray is always looking for new members to fill in the ranks. His company takes more espionage-like missions over mercenary ones. The vast majority of Brigand Dareth members are male, because female drow rarely condescend to take orders from a male. A female drow has to convince Jarlaxle that she would be an asset to the Brotherhood. Brigand Dareth is using one of Jarlaxle's legitimate business enterprises, the Sea Maiden's Fair, as a front in Waterdeep. The Sea Maiden's Fair consists of three carnival ships, the Eyecatcher, the Heartbreaker, and the Hellraiser, crewed by disguised drow and a host of non-drow performers, such as musicians, acrobats, actors, and the like. All three ships are anchored in Waterdeep's harbor. The Eyecatcher is Jarlaxle's flagship. The ship's cargo consists mostly of wagons and floats that can be hastily assembled and paraded through the city. The drow use these parades to draw attention away from their illicit activities. Brigand Dareth is skilled at infiltrating criminal organizations. Xanathar's drow advisor, Gnarl Zebridas, is actually a Brigand Dareth spy. To join Force Grey, one must first become a member of the Grey Hands, an individual who has served in the City Watch or the City Guard is eligible to join, as are characters who swear oaths to defend Waterdeep, its citizens, and its laws with their lives. Force Grey and the Grey Hands are actively managed by Vejra Safar the Blackstaff. Their job is to deal with threats to the city that the Guard and the Watch are not able to handle without risking significant loss of life. They are called upon only as a last resort, since the Lords of Waterdeep tend not to be fond of their methods. Force Grey is an elite cadre of specialized adventurers, drawn from the ranks of the Grey Hands. Whenever Waterdeep has a problem that cannot be handled by diplomats or the city's other armed forces, the Open Lord has the option to mobilize Force Grey. Such action is usually taken as a last resort, since some past members of the group have exhibited a tendency to indulge in wanton violence, causing as much damage as they ostensibly prevent. Due to the escalating violence between the Zentarim and the Xanathar Guild, Vejra Safar the Blackstaff has activated Force Grey and the Grey Hands to deal with the problem. If members of Force Grey and, in some cases, the Grey Hands are arrested for a crime, the Open Lord or the Blackstaff will usually intervene on their behalf and facilitate their release. The Xanathar Guild is Waterdeep's unofficial Thieves' Guild. Long ago, the original Thieves' Guild was outlawed and driven out. Anyone can join the Xanathar Guild, but before membership is granted, an applicant must pass a test that always involves a serious crime being committed. Xanathar's true nature is supposed to be a secret that hardly anyone in Waterdeep knows. Save for a select few, even the guild members do not know that their boss is a beholder. There are 7 colorful NPCs the player characters can interact with at the Yawning Portal Tavern. Some are already members of certain factions and thus can influence the player characters to join their factions. The tavern's owner is Durnan, and he is a man of few words. He is a retired adventurer and does not often venture far from the yawning portal. The barmaid Bonnie is actually a doppelganger and is the leader of 5 doppelgangers. She works at the tavern to make ends meet for her and her gang. Right now, only Matrim Three Strings knows she is a doppelganger. In terms of trustworthiness, only Bonnie can be trusted. The rest of the doppelgangers cannot be trusted. Matrim Three Strings Mereg is a bard that often performs at the tavern. He is a spy for the Harpers and is not open about it. He mainly spies on Zhentarim agents and on other potential troublemakers. He recently befriended Bonnie and wants to help her doppelganger gang settle into the city. The fighter Jalester Silvermane is an agent of the Lord's Alliance and reports directly to the Open Lord, Laurel Silverhand. Since the Yawning Portal attracts adventurers, Jalester's task is to spy on them and discern who might aid or imperil the city and its citizens. Durnan knows that Jalester works for Laurel and leaves him alone. Maelun Wardragon seems like a cheery, optimistic, warm-hearted man. Many at the tavern know he is a skilled fighter and has ties to Force Grey. However, many months ago, an intellect devourer took control of Maelun and ate his brain. The intellect devourer controlled Maelun now spies for the Zenithar Guild. For the guild, he hunts down and kills Zhentarim operatives, but only does this clandestinely. Ubaya Yude is from the southern lands of Chult and is a priestess of Wykeen. How much help she provides the player characters is up to the dungeon master. She is meant to play a more prominent role in the Waterdeep Dungeons of the Mad Mage adventure. Yagra Stonefist is a half-orc Zhentarim mercenary. Her current assignment is to protect an elf named Davil Starsong. Davil Starsong and his former adventuring party called the Doom Raiders now jointly lead the Zhentarim faction that opposes Manchun's faction. Since Davil prefers diplomacy over conflict, Yagra finds her current job boring. If the characters express their opposition to the Zenithar Guild, Yagra might urge them to speak to Davil about joining forces with the Zhentarim. The Dungeon Master decides who the main villain of the adventure is. There are 4 villains to choose from. The villain chosen opposes the player characters, while the other villains become part of the backdrop and could help or hinder the characters. The villains are after the treasure hoard, and the player character's ultimate goal is to keep the treasure out of their clutches. Choosing a villain also determines which season the adventure takes place in. However, the Dungeon Master is free to change villains without changing the season anytime he or she wishes to. Zhenithar is a paranoid, megalomaniacal beholder crime lord. Zhenithar believes the Zhentarim stole the Stone of Galore from his lair. Thus, he has open hostilities with them and seeks to wipe them out. Like all other villains, he wants to retrieve the Stone of Galore and to secure the Cache of Gold. His base of operations is a dungeon under Skullport. Skullport is a gang and crime-infested subterranean settlement beneath Waterdeep. Xenothar has a healthy fear of Laurel Silverhand, does not want to provoke a conflict with the Open Lord of Waterdeep, and is inclined to spare those in her employ. If the DM chooses Xenothar as the villain, then the adventure takes place in the spring. Victaro and Amelia Castellanter are Waterdavian nobles and are secret worshippers of Asmodeus. 3 years ago, the devil-worshipping Castellanterns traded the souls of their children in exchange for power and to escape financial ruin. The eldest son, Osvaldo's soul, was taken immediately and transformed into a chain devil. The Castellanterns keep Osvaldo locked up in their attic. Their two youngest children, Terenzio and Alzarina, are doomed to lose their souls when they turn 9 years old, which is not too far away. The Castellanterns plan to use the cache of gold to buy back the souls of their two remaining children. Actually, a 500,000 gold pieces is not enough. They need almost 1,000,000 gold pieces, and they need to sacrifice 99 souls. From their own funds and with the embezzled gold, they will have more than enough for the gold payment. For the 99 souls, they plan on poisoning the food of an upcoming feast that they will be hosting. Their estate, Castellanter Villa, has a temple of Asmodeus hidden underneath it. Victaro and Amalia rely on their noble status to protect them, and the last thing they want is the city watch on their doorstep. Thus, they will try to misdirect and discredit the player characters rather than murder them. If the DM chooses the Castellanterns as the villains, then the adventure takes place in the summer. Charlexel Bainray is a flamboyant drow swashbuckler. Those who have read the Dritz novels will be familiar with this drow. He is extremely cunning, intelligent, and devious. This villain will probably be the hardest to convincingly run only if your players are very familiar with the Dritz novels and are avid fans of them. Luskan is a pirate city far to the north. Charlexel managed to effectively gain control of the city over its pirate lords. He wants Luskan to join the Confederation of the Lords Alliance and oust Neverwinter from it. He plans to use the stolen gold to buy his way into the Lord's Alliance. Charlaxel also wants the Dragonstaff of Ahgeron for leverage in his negotiations. The Dragonstaff is currently in the possession of the gold dragon Orinax. Charlaxel wears a hat of disguise. He often uses it to be in the magical guise of a flamboyant human sea captain named Zardos Zord. As Captain Zardos Zord, Charlaxel runs a traveling carnival called the Sea Maiden's Fair. Charlaxel layers and oversees things from the Eyecatcher, his flagship, and the Scarlet Marpenoth, which is a submarine that is mounted underneath it. Because he is well-versed in the arts of espionage, Charlaxel loves complicating matters and delights in thwarting his enemies. If the DM chooses Charlaxel as the villain, then the adventure takes place in the autumn season. The original wizard Manchun was one of the founders of the Centaurum. The one in this adventure is a clone, and is hiding in Waterdeep. He has many enemies, including the Harpers, the Blackstaff, Elminster of Shadowdale, amongst others. Thus, he needs to operate from the shadows. He wants to rule Waterdeep as a tyrant. His plan is to get the cache of gold and use it to bribe the Masked Lords into making him the new Open Lord. In addition, he wants to regain control of the Zhentarim faction. Manchun lurks in Kolot Towers, which is a pair of wizard's towers in the Trades Ward of Waterdeep. Manchun creates copies of himself using Simulacrum's spell. He takes great pains to conceal his identity, since his success hinges on not attracting the attention of others who would seek to thwart him before his plans come to fruition. He avoids unnecessary confrontations with adventurers. Only those who enter his extra-dimensional sanctum are likely to incur his wrath. If the DM chooses Manchun as the villain, then the adventure takes place in the winter. Thwarting the villains does not require the player characters to invade their lairs and/or defeat them in combat. So, it is possible to complete this adventure without directly fighting the main villains, who are much more powerful than the player characters, and probably could TPK them easily, even if they were to reach 5th level. That is what I like about this adventure. A world and setting seems more real when characters face encounters that are too easy, and encounters where the wisest course of action is to Of course, most encounters should be appropriate for the player character's current levels. Anyway, because the villains do not want to attract undue attention, they are rarely spoiling for a fight. If a confrontation does occur, the adventurers can be knocked unconscious rather than be killed. Now that I have covered the adventure's background, setup, and initial quest, I can now move on to the next set of adventures in the Waterdeep Dragon Heist Adventure Book. Thank you for watching. Hope this video has been informative and entertaining. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment. I do like feedback. Till next time, this is RPG Mods Fan saying cheers, have a good day, and goodbye. I just can't let you go. Lord knows that I've tried to. You said I was the only one. No one likes being lied to. You made this mess and left me with the pieces. Now I wanna burn all the bridges between us. And left me with